Greetings. On behalf of everyone who is First Presbyterian Church on Hilton Head Island, we are the Wagners, Debbie Wagner and Jim Wagner. And it is our pleasure on behalf of the church to welcome everyone to today's worship. We welcome members and non-members. We welcome families and couples and singles. We welcome youth and children. In fact, children will have a little special message for them after our first song. We welcome folks from the Lowcountry and from around the world. We welcome people of all descriptions and identity and pray that they will feel the presence of God, that we all will feel the presence of God today through our prayers and music and messages and scripture.
Let us now prepare our hearts to worship God through the call to worship from Psalm 1 and Psalm 119. Blessed are those who delight in the word of God, those who ponder God's word night and day. For God's word is a lamp to our feet and a light on our path.
I'm LaVon Stevens, Director of Worship and Music for our Crossroads Service. Please join us in the song of praise. And in these pandemic times, we are made more than just to survive. We were made to thrive. Sing along.
Many dream has died, like a tree planted by the water, we never will run dry.
So living waters flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to
unspeakable,
love unstoppable, anything is possible, joy unspeakable.
And now, here's Jackie Wilhelm with our children's message today.
Good morning, boys and girls. Good morning, church. This morning, I want to talk to you about the importance of God's Word. God's Word is the place I go when I want to feel closer to God, when I want to feel comforted. I go there when I want to learn a little bit more about God. God's Word is very important to me. Do you know where we find God's Word? We find God's Word in the Bible. I have a special Bible I want to show you today. It's called Growing in God's Love. It was written just for boys and girls like you. I'd love to share one of my favorite passages out of the Bible. It comes from the book of John. It says, Jesus said, "I am the light of the world." He wanted people to remember what he was teaching about loving God and loving others. If you follow me and remember what I have been teaching, then you also will be lights in the world. Jesus knew that dark can be scary. When it's dark, we can't see a path to follow. In the dark, it's sometimes hard to see if someone is close by. But with light, life is good. Jesus is the light of the world. Well, boys and girls, I love God's Word, and the church loves God's Word. And we want you to love God's Word too. So over the next couple weeks, we're going to be going around and giving each family one of these Bibles so that we can read God's Word together. I look forward to seeing you soon.
When we dig deep in the Word of God, we realize that we too often rely on the customs of the world rather than the values espoused in Scripture. So we pause each week and come before God and each other, recognizing our need to turn from sin and turn our faces toward God's redeeming love. Let us pray together. Holy God, we confess that we don't depend on you as we should. We forget that you provide everything we need in life. We also fail to follow your Son because we fail to read, study, and ponder your holy word as we should, letting it guide our hearts, direct our thoughts, and correct our steps. God, our Redeemer, forgive us for these and other times that we don't walk in step with your Spirit. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Friends, receive the good news. The light of Christ shines in our darkness to bring light and life to all. By the gift of Christ, our sins are forgiven. This is indeed good news. And it is as a people assured of our forgiveness and living with hope that we open ourselves to the Word of God, speaking into our lives, letting us stay and rest in God's holiness.
Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say, Word of God speak. When you pour down like rain, let me stay and rest in your holiness, Word of God, speak. I'm finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, hear your voice, Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty? To be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay at rest in your holiness, Word of God, speak. Would you pour down my rain, washing my your majesty, to be still and know that you're in the place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness, Word of God, speak. Word of God, speak. Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
Word of God, speak is such a fitting preparation for us to hear the scripture and message this morning. It's also fitting because we are answering your questions about the Bible, the Word of God, this summer, as well as about Christian beliefs. You can hear answers to the other questions that we've addressed in this series on our YouTube channel. This Sunday, we are specifically looking at questions, or trying to address questions, related to how we as Christians should read or understand the Bible. Before we do that, please pray with me. God of grace, by your Spirit, may the scripture we are about to read and the words I'm about to say be your word to us, a lamp to our feet and a light on our journey of faith. Amen. How should we read the Bible as Christians? I'd like to look at that question and attempt to address it through the lens of a particular passage of Scripture, 2 Timothy 3, verses 16 and 17. In those verses we read, "All Scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, so that everyone who belongs to God may be proficient, equipped for every good work." Friends, this is the good news of the Lord. Thanks be to God. All Scripture is inspired by God. What did Paul mean when he wrote those words? We believe he meant at least two things. First, we believe he means that God, through his Spirit, inspired the writers of the Bible. That may mean that God said into the ear of a particular writer in the Bible, "Say this." I think especially of the prophets and what we read on the pages of Jeremiah and Isaiah and Ezekiel and other prophets, "Thus says the Lord." And I think of the Lord then saying to these prophets, "These are the words you will speak to my people." More times than not, though, I think this means that God's Spirit guided the writers as they wrote what we read on the pages of the Bible. It means that the Spirit was at work in them and through them to write what we read in the Bible. All scripture is inspired by God also means something else. We believe it means that God, through his Spirit, inspires us so that we hear the Bible as God's word to us. We hear God's good news of his creation, his salvation, his only Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and in the Spirit's work. And we learned a little more about the Spirit's work a couple of weeks ago when we looked at sanctification and the fruit of the Spirit in our lives as Christians. In the words of John Wesley, all scripture is inspired by God means that the Spirit of God inspired those who wrote the Bible and continually inspires, supernaturally assists those who read it with earnest prayer. Did you hear that? Those who read it with earnest prayer. So when we read the Bible, we should be on our knees in prayer, asking the Spirit to inspire us, to supernaturally assist us to understand it and be able to not just understand it, but to apply it in our lives. That's why we pray in worship when we read scripture and the sermon based on that scripture. We did that earlier. You saw that prayer on the screen. We call it the prayer of illumination or the prayer for illumination. We ask the Spirit in us to illumine our minds and hearts, to shed his light on our minds and hearts, to inspire us then, supernaturally assist us so that we hear it as God's word to us, useful for teaching, for reproof, for correcting, and for training and doing what is right in God's eyes, as we read in 2 Timothy. Without the Spirit, that will not happen. Without the Spirit, the words we read on the pages of the Bible are just words on a page. Let's look at some examples in the Bible to see better what I'm saying here, to see better what Paul is saying in 2 Timothy. We will begin at the beginning, in the book of Genesis, the story of Adam and Eve. We know this story. God creates Adam and Eve. They live in this idyllic Garden of Eden. God says, enjoy your life here, Adam and Eve. Just don't eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. But the serpent in the garden tricks Eve into doing just that. Then Eve offers some to Adam, and Adam eats too. And the rest, as we know, is history. How should we read this story, stories like this one in the Bible? Is it a true story? Is it history? Was there a real Adam and Eve? That is possible. What matters is not whether, though, this story is true. What matters more is the truth or truths in this story. When I read it, asking the Spirit to inspire me, to supernaturally assist me in understanding it, I hear in it the truths about who we are at times in our lives, about us as people who sin. That's obviously what this story is most associated with, about how we don't obey God in our lives, and the truth about how we often have a tendency to blame others. Adam blamed Eve. Eve blamed the serpent. Rather than accept responsibility in our lives, did you do this? God asked them. Not me, says Adam. Not me, says Eve. And we do the same. When I hear this particular truth of blaming and not accepting responsibility, I think of me at times as a boy, and I hear my mother's voice demanding that I or my brother take responsibility for whatever it was that we should not have done. Even if we both did whatever it was, I would sometimes blame my brother. After all, he was the unruly one, while I, of course, was an angel. So it was easy to blame my brother. He was an easy target. Yes, like Adam and Eve then, I've played the blame game. I've denied responsibility. We all have. Politicians are particularly good at playing the blame game. When was the last time, for example, that you remember a politician accepting responsibility for something he or she had done? It's rare, regrettably. They often only take responsibility when evidence forces them to do so, and even then they will only do so grudgingly. Some stories in the Bible are like that. In the words of 2 Timothy, they are useful for teaching us valuable lessons about sin, about who we are at times, what we should not do in our lives, or teaching us valuable lessons about God, about who God is and what God expects of us. In reading the Bible, then, we should ask ourselves, what do we learn in this passage or in this story about who we are or who we should be or not be? Or what do we learn in this passage or story about who God is, what God expects from us, who God is in His love of us? Let's look at another example in the Bible to see how we should read and understand the Bible as Christians. This time, we'll go to the end of the Bible, to the book of Revelation. Revelation is full of exotic creatures and cryptic symbolism, like what we read here in Revelation 6. Then I saw the Lamb open one of the seven seals, and I heard one of the four living creatures call out, as with a voice of thunder, "Come!" I looked, and there was a white horse. Its rider had a bow. A crown was given to him, and he came out conquering and to conquer. When he opened the second seal, I heard the second living creature call out, "Come!" And out came another horse, bright red. Its rider was permitted to take peace from the earth so that people would slaughter one another, and he was given a great sword. These are hard passages to read. There are two more horses that we read about after these verses in Revelation 6. That last or fourth rider is called Death. The four riders are called the four horsemen of the apocalypse. This is apocalyptic literature, literature about the end times. So how should we understand passages like this one in Revelation? As one of you asked me, is it possible that we're experiencing the four horsemen of the apocalypse now? Especially to understand passages like this one and other passages in Revelation especially, we need to have a good commentary in hand. A good commentary will give us the historical background that we need to be able to understand what the writers were saying at the time. We won't know everything, and often there's still many questions we're not able to answer. But that historical background does help us to better understand what the writers were attempting to say, what they wanted us to hear. God does not will. This is what we learn when we have a good commentary in hand on a passage such as this one in Revelation 6. We learn that God does not will what these four horsemen do. He does not will the violence and death that we read. Instead, we learn that it's a result of our own doing, our own sin, our own opposition to God's good purposes that these four horsemen then are unleashed on the earth. When I read a passage like this, it is helpful to have a good commentary in hand. But I also ask the Spirit to inspire me, to supernaturally assist me so that I hear this as God's word to me. And when I do that, I'm able to hear that these four horsemen are powerful metaphors for whenever people thwart God's good purposes, don't do what God would have us do, disobey our God. So these four horsemen of the apocalypse do appear at times in history. I think of John Lewis and other in the civil rights movement. John Lewis and other freedom riders experienced cruelty and brutality of these four horsemen, the people who were like these four horsemen, in their own cry, in their own fight for justice and equality in America. In the op-ed that Lewis penned in the New York Times that was published yesterday on the day of his funeral, he wrote this in part. Emmett Till was my George Floyd. He was my Rayshard Brooks, Sandra Bland, and Breonna Taylor. He was 14 when he was killed, and I was only 15 at the time. I will never, ever forget the moment when it became so clear that he could easily have been me. In those days, fear constrained us like an imaginary prison, and troubling thoughts of potential brutality committed for no understandable reason were the bars. John Lewis experienced that brutality. We think of what occurred on the bridge and the walk to Selma and what occurred there to him. Some parts of the Bible are like that. In the words of 2 Timothy, they are useful for teaching, teaching us that these powerful metaphors speak not only to us about what occurred in biblical times, but speak to us now of what's occurred in our own history, possibly has occurred at our own time even now. In reading the Bible then, we should ask the Spirit to inspire us, to supernaturally assist us so that we do hear these powerful metaphors speak to us historically in the Bible and in our own day. Let's look at one last example in the Bible to see how we as Christians should read it and understand the Bible in our lives. This time, we will go to the heart of the good news, the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. One of you asked, is the story of the resurrection literal or just a story like so many others in the Bible? In other words, do we have to believe it actually happened? Yes. Yes, here we do have to believe it actually happened. As the Apostle Paul writes, if Christ isn't raised, then our faith is in vain. It is worth nothing. But here again, we have to pray for the Spirit to inspire us, to supernaturally assist us to believe this good news, to read the stories in the Bible of the resurrection as true stories, stories that actually did occur. And because they are true, because it actually did occur, to believe that one day we too will be raised to life eternal. Hallelujah. Martin Luther, the spark who ignited the Protestant Reformation in the 1500s, writes this, "We cannot believe by our own reason or strength. It is by the Holy Spirit that one comes to believe in the resurrection of our Lord, comes to believe that it is true and will be true for us." John Calvin, the father of the Presbyterian tradition, agrees with Luther. He writes in his classic definition of faith that faith is both revealed to our minds and sealed on our hearts by the Holy Spirit. So belief in the risen Lord is a divine gift, not a human accomplishment. Listen to this true story that a Presbyterian pastor tells. Michael was a bright and engaging Jew, married to a church member, and a faithful participant in our Bible study classes. There was rarely a question he could not answer or a theological idea he could not explain. When Michael and Carol became parents, they had to decide whether to baptize their baby, Leanne. After much soul searching, Michael agreed to baptize her, and he stood with Carol as she made the promises for their child. Michael's hunger for the scriptures continued. In fact, his chewing upon the word became almost frenetic. I was not surprised when he finally came to see me. He was ready to be baptized himself. He was ready to follow the rabbi named Jesus. He was ready to believe. Why? Because in his intimate dance with Scripture, in his intense study of the Gospels illuminated by the Torah, Michael's heart had begun to burn within him. He recognized the living God in the face of the risen Christ. In powerful ways, the Jesus described in the Bible jumped off the pages and walked out into the world with Michael. Jesus had become Michael's traveling companion, on the journey of his daily life. Some stories in the Bible are like that. In the words of 2 Timothy, God inspires us to hear them as true, true for us in our own lives, so that Jesus becomes our traveling companion on the journey of our daily lives. Hallelujah. Amen. Please pray with me. Ever-present God, when we read the Bible, inspire us, supernaturally assist us by your Spirit through prayer, study, and worship to hear your word to us so that we understand it, apply it to our lives, and live it to your glory. Amen and amen.
I'm Lisa Schrott, one of the pastors here at First Presbyterian Church, and I want to add my welcome to that of the Wagners, who you heard earlier in the service. I invite you to learn more about the ways to be connected to us at First Presbyterian Church through the information in our Sunday worship bulletin. The bulletin, as well as other information, can be found on our church website, fpchhi.org. Please also stay tuned at the end of the service for detailed announcements. The Word of God tells us to love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. In our communal life here at First Presbyterian Church, we have opportunities for you to live these words from Scripture. Love the Lord your God by joining us for worship. While we are still worshiping on Sundays through virtual means, we are offering live in-person prayer services on Wednesdays at noon. Registration is required due to limited seating, and masks are also required. You can find the link to register in the bulletin, or you can contact us at info@fpchhi.org or call the church office. Love your neighbor as yourself by joining us for the dedication of the Habitat for Humanity home for Carolina Ramirez and family on Saturday, August 8th at 10 a.m. The Ramirez new home is at the end of Alex Patterson Road off Marshland Road. All congregation members are invited to attend. Wear your masks and physically distance near the house. Our local outreach ministry is planning a pounding for the Ramirez family. Details can be found in the bulletin, but think about the needs for a family's new home. Use your imagination. You may bring housewarming gifts to the church and place them in the bins outside the church office doors next week between 10 and 4, Monday to Friday. Carolina and her family have been waiting a long time to move into their very own home. We are grateful for First Presbyterian Church members' generosity and all of the Habitat volunteers who have made this new home possible. And it is in gratitude that we offer back to God a portion of what God has so generously given to us. First Presbyterian Church very much appreciates your gifts, tithes, and offerings to help us be the church, to be a voice of hope and love, to be Christ to our community and our world. You can give via the Give button at the top of our website, by mailing a check to the church, or via text. To give via text, send a text to 77977, and in the message box, type FPCHHI. You'll receive a one-time reply with a link to give. Please also know that the church wants to be here to help you with any needs that you might have during this time. So please reach out to us with any needs that you may have. It is with hearts full of gratitude for all that we have received and all of the ways in which we can give back that we turn our hearts and mind to the table where we remember the gifts of the bread and the cup.
Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Jesus said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If those who hear my voice open the door, I will come into them and eat with them, and they with me." We hear the invitation to the table in the Word of God. Christ is a host, and Christ invites us to this joyful feast of the people of God. Our Savior invites all who trust in him to share the feast he has prepared. So come, the table is ready. Come, you who have much faith. Come, you who are seeking more. Come, you who have tried to follow Jesus. Come, the table is ready. Following the great prayer of thanksgiving and the Lord's Prayer and the words of institution, we will share in the Lord's Supper as one body in many places. You may partake with a cracker or a piece of bread or some juice or wine. Join me in prayer. Holy and loving God, we praise you for all your gifts. You created the world and called it good. You made us in your image to live together in love. You made a covenant with us, and even when we turned from you, you remained ever faithful. You sent prophets and witnesses to call us back to you when we ourselves grew weary and stumbled or fell from your way. You gave us the gift of your word, shared through the centuries on scrolls and parchment, leather bound and now on screens. Words that inspire and challenge, words that give wisdom and hope, words that still speak into our lives today. We give you thanks. We give you thanks for your word, O God. And out of your great love, you sent one who was more than a witness, Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Savior. He lived among us, sharing our joys, sharing our sorrows, healing our illnesses, teaching us to care for neighbors, to forgive, to love, and to serve. Dying on the cross, he gave us the greatest gift, saving us from our sins. Healing God, we ask for prayers today for ourselves and our world. For you know our illnesses and our limitations, our fears and secret pains, our unclaimed gifts and discarded dreams. So make us well, we ask, and set us free. Set us free to be your hands in this world. Give us courage to face our challenges. Help us to see rightly, putting to good use what you have entrusted to us, and daring to go in the direction of your voice and vision. Open our hearts and hands to be your comfort to each other and all in need in this hurting world. We ask this and all things in the name of Jesus Christ, who is our hope. Holy God, pour out your Spirit upon us. Spirit, come, come and live in us, in this bread, in this cup, in your people. One in body, one in cup, one in with Christ, one in mystery, in ministry, in this place, in every place. May the bread we break and the cup we bless be for us the communion of the body and blood of Christ, until that day when we will feast with all the saints in your eternal realm. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took a loaf of bread, and after giving thanks to God for it, he blessed it, and then he broke it, and then he said to his disciples, he says to us, his disciples here this day, "This is my body broken for you. Whenever you do this, do it in remembrance of me." In the same way, after he and the disciples had eaten, our Lord took the cup and he poured it out. And then he said to his disciples, he says to us, his disciples, here this day, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood. It is shed for each of you for the forgiveness of sins. Every time you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Friends, every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we do proclaim the saving death of the risen Lord until he comes again, and he will come again. This is God's food for us, God's people. Let us eat, drink, and be grateful. Alleluia. Amen. I'm standing behind the communion table here in Fellowship Hall. This is where we celebrate communion in our contemporary Crossroads worship service, and we know in time we will be able to do that here again. Behind me is evidence of our compassion camp, a camp we have here at the Church for Children this past week, and we will have more children this coming week. They are socially distanced. Protocols of safety are also in place. But they are here to be able to learn God's word, to be able to live God's word in their lives, to live as the Lord would have them live. Hallelujah. As we enter into this week, my charge to us is that we would be like those children. We would be like Michael in my sermon, that we would dive into God's word through study and prayer and worship, asking the Holy Spirit to inspire us to hear it as God's word to us this day and every day, and to then empower us to live it in our lives. Alleluia. Amen. Go in peace.